We're not actors or TV personalities. We're just a couple of guys who want to show you how to restore your car. Sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we consult the pros. But it's never a problem.
Hey, Jeff, how about giving me a hand?
It's always a project.
This week on Autorestomod, Jeff and Vinny bleed brakes, and Vinny asks Jeff to grab his rod.
I'm the master cylinder.
Oh, on the car. Oh, I wasn't sure where that was going.
Order a bunch of parts to get ready for the car show this weekend.
And I got a hot deal, too.
You think? Think again.
Oh, man.
Tired of back orders? You need NPD. With four strategically located superstores, orders are shipped direct to your door within 1 to 3 business days. National Parts Depot has quality restoration parts for Ford truck, Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, and Firebird. For your free catalog, visit NPD online or call toll free.
Ah, clean office is a happy office.
Hey, Jeff, how's it going?
Pretty good, man. I got the instructions for the stainless steel brakes. We're going to do the bleed down today on them.
Oh, I know. I'm really excited about that. You didn't tell me the O-Team was joining us today.
The O-Team's here?
Well, I saw George anyways. He was going upstairs, mumbling about computers, monitors, and something. I don't know.
Yes! I swear you're going to be the death of me before it's over. Give me a freaking heart attack. What's he doing on the computer?
Get out, perhaps. Help you in some way?
What are you doing here?
Working on your computer. I just put your brand new, high-loot, really nice video card in here.
What did you do to my office? It looks like a grenade went off in here.
It's different than you usually keep it?
Well, yeah, when you got here, it was clean. I just cleaned it the other day.
I don't know. It's all right to me. Looks like my shop.
That's what worries me. Well, could you clean up a little before you go? Maybe, like, at least put the covers back on the computers?
Yeah, I could. Probably won't, but...
All right, last week, one of the viewers wrote in and said they didn't like the fact that Vinny did the tool segment because, well, he wasn't good looking enough. Well, here I am, folks. I'm here taking his place. And you're not going to get the good looking chick on here because we just quite frankly can't afford one. So you're stuck with either me or him. So you need to make the pick. But what we're going to do right now is jump right on in the tool segment. Now, what we've got going from left to right are all the specialty tools that we used in this and one specialty tool that we're going to be using in the future. What we start off with is our brake fluid. Now, we're using a synthetic brake fluid on here. There are some people who say that synthetic fluids, they don't like them. There's things that they don't care for about them. We actually like synthetic brake fluid, so we're using that in our car. You don't have to use it in yours. You can use standard if that's what you desire. One thing I really recommend is a bucket for the old fluid and a funnel to get the fluid into the reservoir, because most of the time on these classic cars, the reservoirs are stuck way down inside the well of the engine bay, and they're really hard to get to, and you may get fluid all over the place inside the car trying to pour it straight from the bottle. Another thing we're going to have to use on this probably is a brake line tool. We got this one from Eastwood. It's a really nice handheld tool for doing those small bends that you're probably going to have to do on any kind of brake line setup you're doing when you're doing the conversion to the dual reservoir master cylinder. Another specialty tool that's always good to have is a flashlight, especially when you're working under the dash panel of the car, because it's just going to be really tough to see all that stuff that you're going to be taking apart underneath there. Now, if you get unlucky and you have to take the master cylinder apart, you're going to need a C-clip tool like the one I've got here. This is a really nice one from Craftsman. You don't have to do one quite this expensive. You can just do a plain basic one that you can get just about any auto parts store here in the States. Another thing you may run into is the need for a 10mm wrench. Now, sometimes on some of these wheel cylinders that you use on the drum brakes, they put a 10mm nut on there, and the problem with that is you don't know it until you get up underneath the car. So I'm warning you about this right now. You may have 10mm nuts on the wheel cylinders, and that could cause you a little problem trying to get those undone. So make sure you got a couple metric wrenches laying around loose. You're also going to need a set of line wrenches. We've got a full set of line wrenches here for just about anything we could need on the brake system. Most all of this that you're going to be doing is going to be anything from 5/8 down to 3/8. So just kind of have a nice array of those because you never know when you're going to need the bigger ones. Now on this setup, we're probably going to use our vacuum pump that we've got here on the table. This is an older one we've got. from Mytivac that I've had for years. Works really well, and I typically will use this to do brake bleeding because it's just a lot easier and a lot faster. We've got a Phoenix system bleeder here. This is a really nice system for the guys at Phoenix, and we're going to use this possibly here, but most likely down the road when we put the stainless steel brake lines on from National Parts Depot. So let's get busy. Well, we've got the table pretty much emptied out now. Everything's on the car that needs to be on the car, with the exception of our reservoir setup. Now, what we're gonna do this week is we're gonna show you how to bleed down the brakes, make sure everything is running copacetic.
Now, this is a dual reservoir setup. Now, if you've already got disc brakes on your car, back in the early 60s, they would have had a single reservoir master cylinder still. So this in and of itself is a good safety upgrade because it gives you a separate port for your rear brakes and your front brakes. So if you get one brake line goes out on the car, you've still got some braking power. So no matter what your brake configuration, you definitely want the dual reservoir.
Right, now if you're gonna be doing four-wheel disc brakes, make sure when you do a dual reservoir that you get one for the four-wheel disc setup. There are differences in the reservoir, so make sure when you're ordering that kind of stuff, you make that right. So what I'm gonna do right now is I'm gonna show you how to bench bleed your master cylinder, and Vinny, he's gonna go ahead and get the old master cylinder off the car.
Pulling the old master cylinder is actually pretty straightforward. We've got one brake line that we need to pull off, and then we just have two bolts. Once you get that second bolt loose and out of the way, you may need somebody inside the car to help disconnect that rod from the brake pedal. Hey, Jeff, how about giving me a hand?
Yeah, Vinny, hang on.
Hey, Jeff, I need to grab my rod.
I'm out.
No, I'm the master cylinder.
I'm back in.
Good help is hard to find.
That's why we have you.
If you could just unhook that from the brake pedal, please.
You're assuming I can even find the brake pedal in this mess.
Okay, there we have it.
All right, got the master cylinder off. Now, what we need to do is actually remove this boot. Now, some of these applications, your push rod is going to be actually stuck inside the piston on the master cylinder. So you need something like a screwdriver to help separate that boot to get it up over that lip. Pull it off around it. Now, the reason that you're doing this is the rod that's in here is going to be reused. Vinny, we got a problem. Something actually came off easily. All right, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you actually how this works. Now I'm going to take this boot completely off of here for now and set that aside. The one thing I will show you is this. If you'll look on the paper there, you see that? This master cylinder was already leaking. So you already have a problem going on with your single reservoir master cylinder. And it's fairly typical for these things to start leaking around that piston in the back here. Now, you'll notice on the rod assembly that there is a lip right here. Some of these rod assemblies, there's actually a catch at this point and a C-clip around this, like a round C-clip out around this rod assembly. And that's really tough to get off that piston at times. So what you'll have to do is actually go in and remove the piston from the inside of the master cylinder. You're gonna need a C-clip removal tool to get that out. Or with the rod being down inside the piston like this, you would need to go in and split the piston on this side and on this side, being careful not to cut actually through to the rod so that you can peel that back and pop the rod out. Then you can reuse the rod on your new dual reservoir master cylinder.
So right now, I just have everything in place to do a dry fit. So we've got the master cylinder in place. I don't have the push rod in place just yet. And so I can see that this brake line here for the front brakes, that's actually a really nice fit right out of the box. Now I've got this other brake line for the rear brakes, and we've decided to go ahead and put that on, and we're gonna run it down kind of the fender wall here. And in order for that to fit correctly, we did have to make one bend. This line used to stand like that, and we had to bend it just a little bit out. And that will give us enough room to put in the proportioning valve and be able to run everything. So we're going to start with the proportioning valve. Make sure the connectors are good and tight, and also make sure that you've got the valve all the way open so it'll make it easier to bleed the back brakes. Now, just for the sake of space, I want to go ahead and get the proportioning valve connected without the master cylinder in place, so I've got more room to work. And at this point, make sure to pay attention so you have the outside of the proportion valve going out to the rear wheels. When we did our test fit, we had this brake line, and we expect that brake line to sit right about so. So the brake line that actually goes out to the rear wheels, we are going to have to bend that a little bit to get the proportion valve in exactly the position we want it. The original plan was that we were going to run this brake line right down the fender wall here. That's just not working out so well. So I'm going to go ahead and connect it up. Just like that, and I'm going to leave it just a little bit loose and go ahead and put the master cylinder back in. Now I may have to pull the master cylinder back out in order to be able to get a wrench on this line to tighten it, but I've got to make sure it's adjusted correctly first. Once again, just putting the master cylinder in. This is another check fit. I'll have to pull it out at least one more time. So now I'm finished with test fit number two. And this actually took several minutes to do, and we had to make a couple little bends in the tubing. At one point, we even had to use a hand tubing bender. So I still haven't snugged everything down, but now everything looks good. We don't want any of the tubes touching each other because as the car goes down the road, you get a little bit of vibration that can cause leaks. So one more time, we've got to take everything out and then put everything back in and do a final tightening up of everything. All right, we're going to bench bleed this. Now you want to set the reservoir as level as you possibly can. All you're really doing is priming the area down inside the bottom of the reservoir. So you want to take the top loose. And you've got a clip that goes here on the reservoir. And you'll take the two tubes that come with the reservoir, and they've got little tips on them. You stick this inside the hole in here. And then the other end of it goes down inside the reservoir. Do the same on the front one. Now that you got that done, you're going to want to keep an eye on these two guys because there is a potential for them to pop out and squirt brake fluid out across the shop. So keep your eye on that. Now you just take a screwdriver and put it in the end here. And push, and you'll see bubbles coming out. Now you know why you need to bench bleed this. It's not a fast process, and if you're trying to do this just with the pedal, you'd be here a while. Okay, it looks like we've got fluid in both of them.
Okay, hopefully this will be the last time the master cylinder goes on the car.
All right, Jeff, you good on the inside?
Yep, I got everything but the pin in. I'll do that in just a second here, now that you got all that set up.
All right, now we just have to hook the lines up just like we had them in the last test setup.
Now I'm not gonna go in and hook the cotter pin up on the inside of the interior until we get all the brake lines finalized and hooked into the car. And the reason for that is this. If you're in there trying to put that cotter pin in and you're pushing that brake plunger, you may end up squirting brake fluid all over the outside of the car, and that's not a good thing. Meanwhile, while Vinny's getting that finished up, I'm gonna go ahead and get us ready to bleed the brakes.
Sometimes you just gotta wiggle that line a little bit to get that initial thread started. You also wanna make sure your connections are square. If you don't have them pretty well square when you're connecting them up, you'll end up with leaks, and that'll get pretty frustrating.
All right, now what we're gonna do now is go in and actually bleed down the brakes using the old-fashioned one person in the car pushing on the brake pedal and the other person under the car opening up the line. So we'll just show you how to do that, and then we're going to show you another couple of different methods for bleeding your brakes that are actually pretty quick and easy. Ready, Vinny?
Yeah,
go
ready.
For it.
All right, push the pedal down. Hold it. Holding.
Yes.
Okay, release. Push. Release. Push. Release. Push. Release. Push. Probably better check the master cylinder.
I'm going to go check the master cylinder. Do you need me to release?
Yeah.
This is not what you want your fluid to look like. This is really nasty. This fluid's not really that old. The car's not been driven a ton, but that tells me that we are probably really going to need to get those NPD stainless brake lines and put those on this car because it looks like there's some rust, particulate matter possibly, in the brake fluid.
Now we're going to show you how to use a vacuum style bleeder. With a vacuum style bleeder, you'll have a vacuum pump and a canister. Now, it's really important that when you hook your hose to the bleeder valve that goes to the canister, you hook it to the right side.
The correct side has another little tube that runs down to the bottom of the canister, so the canister will fill up with brake fluid as you're doing the bleed. You want to stop before you accidentally suck brake fluid into your vacuum pump, however, because that can cause damage to the vacuum pump. Just hook our hose up right to the bleeder valve. Okay, just give your bleeder valve about a quarter turn and apply vacuum pressure. Now, a lot of these vacuum pump systems claim it as a one-person job, and it's true, you can bleed the brakes by yourself, but it's a lot easier if you have a second person that can watch the master cylinder reservoir to make sure you don't accidentally drain it all the way down and suck a bunch of air into your brake line.
Yeah, hold Vinny. All right, Vinny, we got about a half a thing here. Let's stop and I'll put some fluid in. I don't like to go much more than a half of the reservoir, because if you do, you may end up seeing more of the fluid go out and then all of a sudden there's nothing in the bowl. Could be bad. Halfway down, you're still good and safe. Another thing you want to do while you're setting all this up is to go in and just check your lines to make sure you don't have any fluid residue on the bottom of these. If there's fluid on the bottom of any of your fittings, that's going to be an air leak, and you're going to be drawing air the entire time you're setting up your brake system. All right, we've got one more thing to go over here. Now we're going to go over the prop valve settings, and that's this. What we decided to do on this particular car is to open that prop valve all the way up so that it's getting maximum flow to the back brakes. According to the guys at Stainless Steel Brakes, you're probably going to be okay starting off there, but you're going to be wanting to be real gentle when you're going out and doing your testing. And the reason for that is this. It can change from car to car, even within the Mustang line, because let's say you've put a Ford 9-inch in the back of your Mustang and you're running the larger 10.5-inch drums or even rear disc with a disc master cylinder on the car. All these little things will add up to a difference in the braking quality out of the back of the car, so that's when you start doing your prop valve adjustments. We're going to go out, do this until we get comfortable with it. We're also going to try to bed in our front pads, so we're not going to be able to get to going in and doing dynamic testing with the braking this week. We will get to that, but it's just not going to be within the next couple of weeks because we've got to go do a couple of other things here in the near future. So we're going to get the car back on the ground, get the hood back on the car, go out and drive the car around and just basically see what we got. Now, what you'll want to do when you're driving the car is just do light braking. Don't go and do anything crazy at first. Stay inside your neighborhood to make sure that the brakes are operating correctly. Don't go nuts and just go straight out onto the street and start driving the car. That's going to be a problem. You want to make sure you got brakes, and that's what we're doing in our neighborhood right now. We're just kind of trying to make sure we've got brakes. We're hitting the brakes every once in a while just to slow the car down. You want to do that when you're working with a setup like this. Now, I will say this. This is a process that you're going to want to go through. Whenever you're doing this kind of a setup, you're going to want to go and then stop, but not hard stops. And you want to go again. You don't ever want to let the car come to a complete stop. You always want to do almost stop and then lay off the brakes. And that's really going to be the important thing with it. And you want to do that several times. And what you're trying to do is you're trying to get the brakes to actually exchange material between the rotors and the pads. All right, now what we're going to do now is we're going to go out onto the main roads. Now what I'm going to say about non-power systems is this. Anytime you got disc brakes involved with a non-power system, your pedal effort may be a little higher, and that's kind of normal. Even back in the day when Ford put the disc brake systems on these cars, they actually put a warning on some of the Shelbys saying that your pedal effort was going to be a little higher. But the trade-off is you don't have to worry about brake fade as much. You don't have to worry about if it gets wet. It doesn't cause the problems that you would have with drum brake systems, which was the fact that a lot of times with a drum brake system, you would get drum brake fade. All right, that's our show for this week, folks. Next, we're going to be coming back to you with one of two things. One of those things would be this. We're going to show you how to fix a panel when there's no replacement panels available for that said panel and how to be creative in doing so. Or we'll be coming back to you with how to do some work on cleaning up and prettying up a 1969 Chevelle Malibu SS. So be sure to come back and watch us next week on Autorestomod. This thing actually brakes really nice now.